funded by a grant from the National Endowment for the Arts. We don't have signs. I want to welcome Nika Lukashev to the stage in a couple minutes. She's an interdisciplinary artist and educator living and working in Los Angeles, and has exhibited at national and international venues, including the Monterey Museum of Art, the Museum of Arts and Crafts, Itami in Japan, the Symbol Art Gallery in Hungary, among others. She's a lecturer of art at California State University, Northridge, and a participating adjunct at Woodbury University. As chair of CAA Services to Artists Committee, she will introduce today's distinguished artists. She's also an independent curator. Thank you so much. Welcome to ARTspace, and I guess I don't need to welcome you to CAA because welcome to your Friday evening at CAA. Thank you for coming to the distinguished artist interviews. I am going to apologize that I'm going to read a little bit, but I want to also announce a couple of plugs here that directly after the distinguished artist interviews, we have art exchange happening to please come to, and tomorrow we have Saturday roundtables in this space, so we hope you can come. So without further ado, I would like to introduce and welcome Coco Fusco and Katherine Bradford, and they will be having interviews and discussions with two other fabulous people. So I'm going to introduce Coco first, and I'm going to also introduce Stephen Nelson first. Towards the end of their discussion, we'll have 15 minutes for questions. So if you could please hold your questions until then for both of our distinguished artists. For their conversation. So Coco Fusco is an interdisciplinary artist and writer whose work explores the relationship between women and society, war, politics, and race. She's the Banks Preeminence Chair in Art at the School of Art and Art History at the University of Florida. She's a recipient of the 2016 Greenfield Prize in Visual Art, a 2014 Cintas Fellowship, a 2013 Guggenheim Fellowship, a 2013 Absolute Art Writing Award, a 2013 Fulbright Fellowship, a 2012 U.S. Artist Fellowship, and a 2003 Herb Alpert Award in the Arts, so in case you didn't know. her performances and videos have been presented at the 56th Venice Biennale, two Whitney Biennials, Freeze London Special Projects, BAM's Next Wave Festival, and several other venues, nationally and internationally. Fusco is the author of numerous books, and her latest is entitled Dangerous Moves, Performance and Politics in Cuba. She's going to be interviewed by Stephen Nelson, a fellow Los Angelian, professor of African and African American art, and the director of the UCLA Center for African Studies. Welcome you two, please. Thank you.
It's on now. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for that lovely introduction, and thank you all for having us here today. It's actually really an honor to be talking with Coco Fusco, who is an incredibly important artist, but more importantly, she's like a girlfriend. And so it's funny to do this on stage with Coco because we've been talking for about 20 years. And what do you do when you sort of have a public conversation? I think we were calling it lunch. And so here's like this recreation of this kind of conversation we've been having since about 1997 when we dragged Coco up to Tufts University where I was teaching at the time. about how you would talk about your various practices, be it performance or installation or writing even, within that kind of area, arena.
Mm-hmm. Wow, that's a complicated question. Hi, Stephen.
Hi.
Hi, everybody. Okay, so let's see. I think, you know, my undergraduate work was in semiotics, specifically film semiotics, and I had some really brilliant teachers. Mike, is that better?
Yes.
So my undergraduate work was in semiotics, specifically film semiotics, and I had some really brilliant teachers, among them Marianne Doan, who some of you may know, who's now at Berkeley but was at Brown for many years. And you know, I spent a long time learning about the gaze. And I think that Marianne's lessons never left, in a way. But I think also that my first kind of forays out of the protected environment of school, in which I had to encounter sort of in real life questions of cultural perception, cultural misperception, cross-cultural perceptions, cross-cultural misperceptions, that this sensitized me to the limits of written language and also of an analytical framework for thinking about gazes. And because there were just strange things happen in real interpersonal interaction that can be sort of written off when you're thinking behind a desk, right? And I was telling Stephen earlier that I think that a really important role model for me is Adrian Piper, who I was lucky enough to meet when I was in my 20s and who was very kind to me and very supportive, and we shared some panel discussions, but she also was, you know, really acted like a mentor. And I learned from what she was doing at the time that you could extract from autobiographical experience scenarios and paradigms that could then be expanded upon so as to speak to larger concerns of these kinds. And so I also felt a great kinship with her in that, you know, she is a philosopher, she writes, and she thinks a lot about theory, but she also understood the power of the performative and of interaction in real time and space as a kind of laboratory for thinking about cross-cultural perception and misperception. So, you know, I think that therein lies sort of the origin of my interest in gazes and spectacle.
Yeah.
Marianne's work on masquerade was very important for me as a student. And it also made me understand this kind of distancing mechanisms that could be enacted in performance through costume, through excess, through kind of Baroque adornment of the body, but basically of not just positioning of the body, but costuming of the body. A Brazilian documentary filmmaker did a piece about me in 2005 called "I Like Girls in Uniform," because he said, "Oh, you know, you have all these pieces where you're wearing a maid's uniform, or you're wearing a maquiladora worker's uniform, but uniform was a way to abstract an experience from a personal level and go to a more kind of paradigmatic level of all those in this position, right?" So, in terms of testimony is a very troubled area for post-colonial art and practice. You know, I hope Hal Foster's not in the room, but you know, he doesn't have a lot of very nice things to say about artists who work with personal experience and testimony. Let's start there and end there. I also, as an artist and as somebody who I like to think of myself in a way as a kind of public intellectual, that I also see the problems of being too reductive with testimony and also a presuming truth in testimony. That said, when you leave the kind of higher realms of sophisticated art institutions and art history, and you try to find out about histories that are not part of dominant narratives, testimony is one of the only places to go. And whether that testimony is articulated through oral history or through song or through signed as sworn affidavits, which is what I'm working with right now for my next performance, sworn affidavit eyewitness accounts of the Namibian genocide, or the testimony of prisoners in Abu Ghraib and Bagram and Gitmo, which was the starting point for the development of the work that I did about military interrogation. There's nothing else for me to work with. It's not like I could go to a library and find 200 articles by social theorists or historians or anybody else about some of the social realities that I want to use in my practice. So the challenge then becomes for me as an artist, what do I do with the material? How do I reshape? I'm not an Amnesty International officer, right? I'm an artist, but this can be my material and I can sculpt it into something else, into something more. And particularly when the testimony speaks to larger issues, to historical trends, to painful truths. I'm pretty liberal in the way that I edit testimony. I hope that I don't distort words, but in a performative scenario, in a museum where people spend on the average something like 2.7 minutes looking at an artwork, if I start to read 500 pages of testimony, I'm going to lose the audience. So I have to find in that 500 pages the 50 words that will keep people in front of me for long enough to hear them.
So this is really super interesting. What are you hoping to find, though? Because, there is the testimony in it, and you have found these documents.
I'm not ignoring you. I'm just turning this on again.
We'll go off in 15 minutes again, because that's how we roll. I'm really fascinated by what you do with testimony, because testimony is slippery and it goes towards the personal and it goes towards the autobiographical and when you start to work with it, there is always that danger that because you're using the personal, suddenly your own work becomes seen as not certified, but personal.
Well, you have to have an eye for what speaks to larger issues and concerns. That's one thing. I have to be a good editor. But I'll just give you a more concrete example, okay? When I mentioned before the project that I did between 2005 and 2008 about military interrogation and the deployment of female sexuality as a Western female sexuality, in quotation marks, as a weapon against presumed Muslim terrorists, right? And so how was I going to I knew that there was, because a story was leaked by an interpreter who had been in the room with the so-called 20th hijacker when a female interrogator came in with the fake menstrual blood and wiped it on his face. And the guy had already been waterboarded, this, that, everything. Every kind of horrific torture experiment had already been practiced on this man. But apparently the menstrual blood fake, but he didn't know it was fake, was sort of the straw that broke the camel's back, and he freaked out, and she got scared of what she had produced, and if the account is true, was also a little bit upset about what she, she kind of realized that she had gone too far, and she wasn't comfortable, and so she left the room, right? And then I was so shocked in a way, but also so stunned that this would be a method employed by a professional and that somebody had thought it through. And so I was like, well, how can I find out more? If I'm going to create a character, my goal was to create a character who was a female interrogator who really believed that she was carrying out a patriotic duty in deploying her sexuality to serve American interests. How could I find out more? Well, I did interview female interrogators And then I went to the testimony, because in the Tacuba report, there was testimony from dozens of detainees or prisoners in Abu Ghraib and Bagram and about what was being done. And there was a repeated kind of a referencing of being humiliated by these female soldiers, which was then backed by when I went to interview a woman who was an intelligence officer who had been brought in. She was not originally an interrogator, but she was brought in by male interrogators in, I think it was Bagram, because they wanted a woman who would demean the prisoners as a woman, like start talking about how small their genitals were and make fun of them naked and things like that. And, you know, so she was, in a sense, backing the truth value of that testimony. And then I read another account by somebody who had been at Bagram who talked about pulling in any woman on the base to use them. So, and then the Pentagon had, was, you know, I was on search engines all the time looking for intimate. The Pentagon had come out and said, yes, we have, this is a strategy, using women and using female strategies. But to get the details, because there is no manual that described this. There was no official in Washington who was willing to say this is a strategy. To get a sense of the detail, because if I'm going to create visuals and create a character, I need details. I can't just speak in abstractions, right? So then I could go to the, look at each story, each testimony, and then from those I distilled 16 or 17 scenarios in which women were using their sexuality. Then work, find an illustrator. In the United States, the designer of the book I was working on, and I could not find an American who wasn't afraid to do this. So we worked with a Canadian illustrator, hire actors, put them in the poses, describe the testimony. Then from the photographs, create the illustrations. Then write the text using the same rhetoric that was used in the official field manuals for interrogators, but to apply it to these strategies to codify visually what I understood to be a strategy that wasn't being acknowledged. So, but those are the stages, and testimony is at the root, but it doesn't end at testimony. It becomes more meaningful when I gather all of that together and make a system out of it, right?
Well, and I think that that system then gets you, I think it gets you around what you said in terms of the limits of written language, the limits of language. And it seems to me that your practices try to sort of break that semiotic chain, and one that sort of has its reverberations in love and in life, right?
All sound very intelligent when we talk, and especially when you talk at academic conferences, everybody sounds really. But we don't behave in a very intelligent way.
No.
Even people who claim to be very intelligent, we don't behave in a very intelligent way, particularly when nobody's watching and we feel that we're caught off guard. It's difficult for me in a professional milieu to be anonymous at this point, but when I have performed in contexts in which my identity is not known, I get to see a lot more about the very strange things that people do, particularly around issues of race and race and gender, and then let me say race again. You have to create certain conditions of anonymity to see that kind of behavior come out in the open, which is what the Cage piece was about, right? It was about the kind of allowing the spectacle to take over and allowing people's fantasies to emerge. And in order for that to happen, I had to be invisible.
Right. And the beauty of that is that people don't realize that you were watching them watching you.
Yeah.
So
the time, the moment to stop the piece was when there were more anthropologists watching than people doing.
That's a really good point. And but you know what I'm interested in, because clearly, you know, we're talking about you know, your work and decades of your work that attend to different, you know, different political realities at different political, you know, different moments in our political lives, right? And you know, as we were talking about earlier, it's always easy. The easy equation is, okay, you know, Coco Fusco's work makes an intervention in, you know, thinking about Occupy and thinking about the sort of exotic spectacle of otherness or in the torture of public rape. But what I would love to hear you think about is if I were to flip that equation and to ask you how a given political moment affects what and how you do what you do.
Okay. Is this better? Sorry.
Yes.
Okay. So my being in the world was the product of a political moment. It was the my mother was deported from the United States in 1959, and she didn't want to go back to Cuba, and so she got pregnant with me to be able to stay in the United States. And the decision, and there was an argument between whether or not I should be taken to Cuba permanently or just temporarily to get her papers to come back to the United States, between her and my father, right? And so, you know, I wouldn't have been born if there wasn't a Cold War and a Cuban Revolution. So, where I ended up living had to do with becoming the anchor baby that could guarantee the entry of the rest of my family into the United States. So, you know, there's never been a moment, you know, in my life when there hasn't been some kind of external thing that is impacting me. I was also impacted by civil rights. I mean, my parents, a couple of years later, ended up getting married, but their marriage was null and void in many states in the United States until the early 1970s because it was an interracial marriage, and so we never traveled to the states where their marriage wasn't recognized, and they never went there even after it was legalized because they were so freaked out by there being laws against their being together. But then, you know, my decision to have an afro when I was in high school was about wanting to, you know, be kind of out there, and my mother and my grandmother and my aunts were crying and saying that I looked like Angela Davis and that I was going to get arrested because this was when Angela was a fugitive and other black women were getting arrested for having an afro. So, you know, where do you want to go? I mean, if you're asking me more recently, I do have a very specific recollection that when 9/11 happened, and I'm like, in the days afterwards, when there was this kind of the revving up of the war machine was so intense, and the outpouring of this very kind of knee-jerk patriotism and the sort of the symphonic music coming out of Washington to support the war, and I really felt very deeply in me that the country was moving in to the far right. And that if I was going to survive mentally, that I would have to put as much of my intellectual and creative energies toward responding to my dismay at that. Mm-hmm. And you know, my decision to work on the whole kind of military interrogation thing came out of a response to the legitimation of torture by the courts and by the presidency. That's why I did the work. It wasn't because I felt I got a dream in the middle of the night, and that it was because I felt that I had to say something, and that this was the way to do it. A lot of the work that I do about Cuba is also because in the last few years it has been more. I've been going to Cuba regularly since 1984. I've collaborated with artists there in a number of different ways. I've written about Cuba. I published a book about Cuban performance art. But in the last 6 or 7 years, it has become easier for me because of the loosening of restrictions on technology ownership, and also the increase of the touristic presence with cameras. It's been much easier for me to smuggle equipment in and to do work to shoot without permissions. If I ask for permission from the Cuban government, I'm never going to get it for anything I want to do. So it's better to work without permission. But if you worked without permission 30 years ago, when nobody had a camera, you stuck out like a sore thumb, and it would be much more. It would have been much easier for to have my material confiscated. Now I am much more adept at navigating a police state, and I know what to do and how to get my camera where I want it to be. So I can. That's so I've been able to make a lot more video, you know, since 2010 in Cuba than I was able to do before. So that's a political, you know, that's a response to a changing political landscape. So I, you know, I mean, sometimes my historical, my view of politics is much more long durée, and you know, like the project that I'm working on now about the Namibian genocide has to do with a much longer interest that I've had in colonial archival material, and you know, that comes out of the work that I did on the Caged Amerindian performance, but also on the Only Skin Deep curatorial project that I worked on for like 4 years about the history of race relations in American photography, where I went into archives for 2 years and just dug around and found all these weird pictures. So, you know, the archive, that archive is very important to me. You know, it's important to me personally, but it's also important to me creatively, as a kind of storehouse of material to reshape.
Mm-hmm. So the reshaping, would you say that that's, you know, I'm thinking about this sort of line that I think you walk on and straddle between what we think of as the document and the artwork. That, you know, and this is different from artist social work,
right?
Which we don't want to talk about, right? But thinking about this project, the current project, can you talk a bit about this sort of fine line that you've struggled since the beginning, really, between what we would take as true and what we would understand as fiction, and how it really just gets screwed up in your practice?
Okay. Well, I mean, I could answer in a very straightforward way, or I could answer in a very long and complicated way. Right? If the focus of the experiment is on reader response, right, audience perception, then, you know, the biggest lesson that I learned from the Cage Amerindian performance was that those perceptions have a life of their own, that I can put things out there in the world, but I cannot control what people do with them. I'm always asked, especially by young people, about, you know, what's your goal and what do you want to audiences, and I'm like, you know, it's one thing to be a teacher when you can like teach material and give a test if you're really a pain in the ass and you want to make your students suffer, and then you can see if they got what you wanted them to get, right? But if you can talk long enough, you know that really students don't understand what you taught them until maybe 10 years later.
Yeah.
And then they write to you and they say, gee, you really changed my life. Right?
No.
So you know, and this is for all those of you who worry about student evaluations. Don't worry, you know, because they don't know, they don't really know what they think about what you taught them until a long time later. I can't control what happens. No artist really controls what happens to their work, okay? But I think that, you know, I'm not the only person to deal with this. I think every artist who deals with sort of legacies of colonialism, whether it has to do with ethnic and racial stereotyping, or whether it has to do with work with any aspect of that history, you know, on the one hand, that the history is deeply flawed and problematic because it's been written by the conquerors, and that you are going to have to make an intervention and tease out of documents that are not yours the stories that you feel closer to you, So that's, you know, the post-colonial artist's dilemma is how do you take a history that wasn't yours and make it yours, right? And it's not just a post-colonial artist dilemma. I did a project for my solo show in 2016 here in New York that had to do with the documents around the Padilla case, which was a very famous case of Ebecto Padilla, a Cuban poet who was censored, and basically whose entire life was destroyed because he wrote a book of poems called, you know, Fuera del Juego, Outside the Game, in which he questioned authoritarian systems of power. So I was able to access, through an historian colleague, documents that were classified by the Cuban government about all the other authors that were censored because of their support for him, starting with Jean-Paul Sartre and going to Vargas Llosa and down the line. Every big literary figure of the 60s was involved in his case. And so I made facsimiles of those documents. So they were fake documents, right? But it was the only way to put out into the public a story that had been suppressed by the state. So it's not just that, you know, colonial history is written by the colonizers, it's that states also control information about history, and sometimes you have to kind of tease out another version through whatever means you have, right? So, you know, I this is material that I work with in the same way that somebody else might work with clay or some textile. This is material. Politics remains material, and state power is expressed in the document. So if I'm interested in power, and I'm interested in power and working with power, then I have to go to the manifestations of power. And an important manifestation of power is the document, right? Whether that's a photographic document, a filmic document, or a written document, documents are articulations of power. You know, am I beholden the way an attorney would be to, you know, being faithful? No. But the original documents in and of themselves are not faithful to the histories they purport to represent. So, you know, but I also, you know, I don't have an ethical dilemma with this, but I think that others have an ethical, impose an ethical dilemma on whatever they want to perceive as non-Western, non-white, non-what you name it, artists that supposedly were only as good as our faithfulness to some truth about who we are. And I'm like, oh my God, you know, this is just so retarded. It's like, which artist would want to work with that restriction? It's just completely antithetical to the work of the imagination. So, but you know, I have been, had the distressing experience of being called in by foundations to ask about the authenticity of certain honors of color based on, you know, rumors circulating about their inauthenticity because they're not light, because they're too light, because their affiliation to a particular ethnic group is questioned, because of this, because of, and you know, it's painful. Those that demand for truth that does come from institutions that wield power is really quite distressing and is real. So that makes me not want to completely laugh off the power of the document.
And I think that's really, really an important point, because the other, you know, seeming though the elephant in the room, as it were, is always this sort of expectation of the authentic artist of color.
Whatever that is,
it's a fiction, right? and so the question and the issue and the complication, I think, at times becomes, when does one ever take up that mantle, or does one instrumentalize that as part of the sort of more sort of broadly thought out world of art making?
You know, there are times when it's important to deploy what you know in the service of some greater good. There are things that I know because of the experiences that I've had, and a lot of that knowledge comes from, not from books, it comes from life and family, and, you know, but at the same time, I can't presume to know things just based on a bloodline. You know, so I think it's something that one has to be careful about because, you know, for all the kind of my being schooled in post-structuralist theory and being able to argue with anybody in here, you know, ad infinitum about the sort of precarity of truth and the relativity of things. You know, I still, you know, in a more activist sense, believe that there's a reason to argue for real representation of real people of color in institutions of power. Okay. And I will not give that up, no matter how many Derrida books I read in college. because it makes a difference. It makes a difference, and also because unfortunately, too many people who are not do not hail from those ethnic groups really don't adhere to that as an ethical principle. Not necessarily out of a kind of overt racism, but out of a kind of willed ignorance of the issue altogether. So that, you know, it's like, how did I end up in the place where, it's all white people in need? You know, like, how come I have to be the one that has to be raising this issue in 2017? But, you know, this continues to happen. As long as that happens, then I have to continue on occasion to be sort of strategically essentialist about things.
So we're going to take a few questions. Did you want to read your
first? Yes, you have seen this charming image here. I have, on request of Occupy Museums, a statement to read from them. It has come to our attention that a Trump economic advisor sits on the board of the Museum of Modern Art. The name of this advisor is Larry Fink. He is the founder and CEO of BlackRock, Inc., the largest financial company in the world. BlackRock barely existed before 2008. Today it manages $5.1 trillion of assets. If you hold any kind of debt to any bank, chances are that it's traded by BlackRock. This firm is deeply invested in Americans and especially students to remain in permanent debt. Fink is also on the board of NYU. Which is one of the most expensive universities in the country. Fink is not in Bannon's camp, he's a liberal. He was talked about as a potential Clinton Treasury Secretary, but now he's on Trump's team. And because Trump is waging a war of hate and lies against Muslims, immigrants, women, LGBTQ, disabled, and the planet itself, one cannot reasonably advise or do any kind of business with this regime. To advise this regime is to normalize white supremacy. There is a long history of activism in MoMA. In fact, tonight's free museum entrance was brought to you by the Art Workers Coalition's protests decades ago. So in this tradition, we are calling for MoMA to change its behavior, no more normalizing Trump. We are calling for Larry Fink to be kicked off the board as a sign to your public that you care for our values of human dignity. MoMA, why are you normalizing this regime by having a Trump advisor on your board? Larry Fink of BlackRock, Inc., MoMA, time to dump Trump, Fink off the board. Please meet at MoMA lobby at 6 p.m. sharp today. Avoid the lines and go in. Please do not share this on social media. Thank you.
Thanks. So we're going to open up. Thank you. Okay. We're going to open up for we have time for a couple questions from the audience. And if anyone would like to ask or get
in. I've always been troubled by the term post-colonial. I've always been troubled by the term post-colonial. I spend a lot of time working in Mali, in West Africa, and it's clear to me that colonialism has never ended. It's alive and well. Its form might have changed, but this term post-colonial really bothers me every time I hear it, because I think it normalizes the idea that colonialism ended, and it has not.
Well, I think that I don't disagree with you that there are structures that exist that are a product of the colonial era, but in a political sense, the actual political regime of colonialism has mutated to a different form, right? So I'm not disagreeing with you. I'm just saying that I think there is a political distinction to be made between the colonial era and whatever you want to call the era that we're in now. And that does not preclude there being structures of power and modes of exploitation that are as egregious and as extreme as there were in the colonial era. That said, you know, I mean, I don't like the term post-racial either, I don't like the term post-feminist either, but these are terms that are used, and there are, you know, schools of post-colonial studies, journals, books, so if I want to invoke a kind of field of inquiry, then I have to use that for lack of a better term.
How about neo-colonial?
Well, you know, fine. I don't, you know, the thing is, like, I think it's really important. Okay, and I acknowledge that you think it's really important, and I don't disagree with you, but at the same time, I have to, you know, kind of, in shorthand, in an hour, make reference to a very large body of writing. Yes.
Come on up.
Right, this is like the Price is Right.
It is the Price is Right.
Right.
Thank you for the
wonderful talk.
Here's my question. I think that this statement about moments is very important. And my question is, what about when it comes to the individual artist, and particularly the artist who has been on both sides of the power dynamics? So specifically, my question to you is, should David Hammond adopt Newton Gallery, since Newton Gallery is also in some way responsible or connected to Stephen Mnuchin, who will now be Trump's Secretary? Or is it only Obama's responsibility to dump
If I try to tell David Hammond what to do, and you know, I love David. I love him as a person. I also love his absolutely irreverent persona. And I have profound respect for him as an artist and as somebody who really, you know, did what he wanted to do without caring if anybody supported him for so long, you know. So I'm not, you don't deal with David Hammond by telling him what to do. You just don't. You know, that is not a way to communicate with David Hammond. So I'm not going to tell David Hammond what to do. If David Hammond wants to make an art piece about letting go of the gallery, go for it. And if he doesn't, then that's who he is as an artist. I don't address individuals in the same way that I would address an institution, but also I hope I made it clear I was asked by Occupy Museums to read this. I didn't compose that statement. That was Occupy Museums' statement.
We have time for one more question, and it is you.
Hello, is that on?
Okay. That's my
Fusco, I want to say, as a New York media maker, your work was so influential in the transition from making media to studying through the Indigenous Studies program at the University of Hawaii. And in your, especially your work with the Unremitting Project and Homeless Indeed, and as those of us who work in this space of Indigenous media and arts and in the internationally engaging community, we find that we're bringing a new conversation. Well, it becomes a new conversation when our conversations about race and indigeneity overlaps that, because there are Sami's who are Indigenous, who are white, Black Indigenous people, and Indian, and so on. And I was wondering if any of your future projects, even this one in the media, is perhaps, is it ongoing, do you have an ongoing interest in the way that indigeneity as an idea intersects with race in the
You know, I don't really organize my projects that way, like, okay, now I have to think about this and this issue and that issue. I believe it or not, even though I, you know, read and write and can, like, talk about theory, I actually do come to my projects in a different way that really has to do with soaking up a lot of experiences and materials and readings and artworks that interest me, and waiting and using the mind as a kind of sieve to see what rises, you know, what floats to the top, right? And what is what's moving. So if there were a project in which that where I felt that way about it, you know, at a very intuitive level, then I might carry it out. That said, I have to say that the response that Guillermo and I got in the South Pacific to our work was mind-boggling from indigenous groups in the South Pacific. And that, you know, the friendships that I formed with Samoans and Maori were amazing as a result of that. And I learned stuff that I will, you know, I mean, I had unforgettable experiences, but I learned so much about Aboriginal activism in Australia and in New Zealand as a result of the dialogue. And it started because we had to get their permission to perform anything on an Indigenous theme in Australia. And the conversation was a lively one, and it was a fantastically moving one to have their support. Yeah, to have their support. And so that, you know, when some years later I went to Auckland to perform, and these Maori guys came to the rescue of me and Neo Bustamante, who I was performing with at the time, and did everything for us because our organization that invited us was totally unprepared. You know, we were moved to tears, and then at the end they stood up and they did a Maori dance after we performed. You know, I mean, what greater honor can you have, right? So these are amazing experiences, and they're moving ones. And same, you know, a couple of years ago I was in Chiapas and was asked to do a closed door workshop with Mayan women theater performers who wanted to basically pick my brain about how to be economically independent and get touristic academics off their back, who always wanted to photograph them endlessly. And you know, they demanded the meeting, but they're like, we know what you do, you're gonna tell us how to get rid of this problem. And it was also an incredible encounter, an unforgettable encounter. So, you know, those, to me, those dynamics and dialogues are as important to me as making some art about the issue. You know, it's also about bonds, right? About community bonds.
I'm afraid that's all the time we have. I want to thank you all for being here, and please join me in thanking you for being here. You're a wonderful audience.
Thank you. I know everybody wants to go to her.
the only one who understands me. So thank you for staying. Thank you for enjoying our distinguished artists. Thank you to our distinguished artists for coming. But you know what I didn't say? I need to thank my committee, the Services to Artists Committee, for the work they do and to get this program going, and CAA for putting this together. But especially on my committee, who worked on this last year and this year, specifically worked to find these wonderful artists. And I see them in the back, and they have no idea. I just want, just stand up for me. Joan Giroux, Zoe Charlton, thank you. So like this committee comes in, we pay and we work here. So just so you know, we're here for you and we're excited that you get to have this program and we get to all have this and share this. So shall we have a wonderful next set of distinguished artist interviews, please? Katherine Bradford is a New York-based artist represented by Canada in New York and has a studio in Brooklyn. She's exhibited her work nationally in numerous solo shows. Her work is held in collections of the Metropolitan Museum of Art, the Brooklyn Museum of Art, the Portland Museum of Art, and the Farnsworth Museum. In 2011, she received, a Guggenheim Fellowship and an American Academy of Arts and Letters Award. In 2012, she received a Joan Mitchell Foundation grant. She was a resident faculty at the Skowhegan School of Painting and Sculpture in Maine, and for 16 years she was on the MFA faculty at the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts in Philadelphia. Currently, she's a senior critic in the graduate painting department at the Yale School of Art. She is joined today in conversation with painter Judith Bernstein. Judith is a New York artist, best known for her phallic drawings and paintings. She uses her art as a vehicle for her outspoken feminist and anti-war activism, provocatively drawing psychological links between the two of those things. She has just had a piece, were any of you at the Whitney? She just had a piece at the Whitney Portrait Show entitled Human Interest, the show. It was a lovely show, if you saw it. She's represented in New York by the Mary Boone Gallery, if that's of any significance. Currently, she has a solo exhibition at the Box LA called Cock in the Box, and they also represent her on the West Coast. And she's represented in Europe by Karma International. Judith and Katherine met at SUNY Purchase, where Katherine earned an MFA and where Judith is an adjunct faculty member. So these two amazing ladies are now in their 70s and both enjoying more attention than ever. So please help me welcome Katherine Bradford and Judith Bernstein. Make sure these are working. Thank you for inviting us. Thank you for letting me play with the format a little. And thank you for that introduction. So Stephen and Coco's conversation started in 1996, right?
Yeah.
Judith and I began our conversation in the 80s. I was in my 40s. And starting the MFA program at SUNY Purchase, where Judith was on the faculty. I went to a good college that had a good history of art program, but no studio art program. So I had never been to an art school at that point. What I remember is that Judith was teaching a course on how to draw giant drawings in charcoal, right?
I don't remember. But letting you be the authority on this one.
But I was way too uptight to take that course. So
I think it was outscale drawings. Is this on?
Yes, it is.
Okay. But you have to hold it really close.
Oh, really close.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so out of scale drawings was something that I didn't think I could get into at the time, but I do remember Judith coming to an all faculty critique of my work, and they were discussing the forms of my work because I started out as an abstract mark maker type of artist, and I remember Judith saying that one of the shapes in one of my paintings was nipple-esque.
I have no idea.
She said that, and I didn't forget it, and I perked up. I thought there's lots of ways to be an art professor. That's what I thought. Judith had an MFA from Yale, and she had already gone through a very lively art world scandal where her early large screw paintings were censored from an exhibition in Philadelphia. You probably know about that.
So it was in 1974.
And they were taken out, right? You couldn't show them.
That's correct. They were not shown. That's correct, yeah.
So I already knew about that. So at this point in my life, we were way far apart. In a way, I think of myself in those early years as part of one of those marginalized groups in the whole art world, which is a housewife who wants to paint. And here we are.
You got it.
Judith and I were born in the same year, 1942, and the streams of our trajectory are quite different, and we wanted to talk about that today. I was raised in Connecticut, which is a fact that I'm more in the closet about than being a lesbian.
And rightly so.
And we were not to talk about certain things. We were not to talk about money. We were not to talk about sex. And we were not to talk about ourselves. So I thought Judith Bernstein would be the perfect collaborator with me today, and I'm so glad she's here. We're calling our conversation the long road, and we hope you have some questions about it. And we thought that actually you didn't have to wait to the end.
That's correct, yes. Yeah. If you have any questions while we're speaking, just raise your hand. It makes it more casual. And also, you can ask right at the time. Wait, we're going to... You're first on the line, by the way. Don't worry about it.
So I'm going to describe my early years, and maybe you can really go with your early years. But I started painting when I was living in Maine, and the first place I showed my work was at the local pizza place. Actually, it was a pretty cool pizza place. And I was married and I had two kids and was leading a very rural, time-consuming lifestyle when I realized that I wanted very badly to be an artist, a real artist. We had an organic garden, we had a wood stove, wood piles, and so I gradually had to reconfigure my life so that I had the time and the space and the money to make art. I moved with my two children to New York in the 80s, and when they were old enough to be somewhat on their own is when I enrolled in the MFA program at SUNY Purchase.
My turn?
Your turn.
Okay. You know, I became an activist, and I'll tell you why. I became an activist in a long, long time ago. What happened was I came from a very small town in New Jersey. I went to Penn State as an undergraduate, and when I went to Penn State, there were three men to every woman. And then I went to Yale, and at that time, Yale was an all-male school. And from Yale, one of the first day at Yale, Jack Torpo said, we cannot place women after we graduate, after they graduate, meaning we could not get an academic job. So I hit another glass wall there. There were always women in the graduate program, but very few. There were only three in my class. Then I went.
And now the class is half.
Absolutely. Things have changed enormously. And the same with Penn State. Instead of three men to every woman, it is a whole different ballgame. Then I went to New York and hit another glass ceiling or roadblock or whatever. And I joined AIR Gallery. I later on became part of the Guerrilla Girls and stuff like that because I knew that I was a deep shit. So the fact that the opportunities for women were very limited. When I was a graduate student at Yale in the 60s, I read an article. This is my trajectory in terms of how I got the imagery that I became well known for. I read an article in the New York Times, and it said, "Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf?" And it was an Albee play, and that was actually taken from Bathroom Graffiti. A light went off, I went into the men's room and looked at graffiti, and that was a real insight. Those scatological graffiti were actually much deeper than you would imagine, because the scatological stuff, when someone is alone in a bathroom, a man is alone in a bathroom defecating, he's also into his subconscious. So it was coming out the other end. So I used those graffitis, and they were a lot of anti-war. This was actually the Vietnam War time, and people were, the men were terrified that they would have to go to war. So I started with that, and I did a whole Fuck Vietnam series, and somewhat recently shown. They were they also used a lot of graffiti. There was a man flying through the air with a cape on, with a zipper on, super cock. Cock three times the size of him, and this may not be heaven, but Peter hangs out here. There were a lot of very crude phalluses, giant phalluses that I made that were Fuck Vietnam, and so I started out with the Fuck Vietnam. Then I went to drawings of screws because it was a pop art time. Screws drawing and being screwed. Use those images. And the images of screws became a combination of war, sex, and feminism. Mine's bigger than yours, and they were gigantic, and they were very empowering. They had a lot of energy, and they were extremely impactful. Then from there, I also started doing these very large drawings of my signature, and they were about stardom. They were about ego, they were about male posturing, and they were also about my ego. And they were also about putting women in the center. And I'm here, and I don't want to be forgotten. So that was an important element. Then from there, I was thinking of, how can I go somewhere else with the imagery that I have? And then I started thinking, of course, of the vagina, which was great, the cunt, the
anger. Oh, hold it, Judith.
What?
Judith gave me permission that I could interrupt her at any time.
You got it.
So, yeah, I think you're going from early to more recent.
That's correct. I actually went from the 60s with Vietnam, then I went to the 70s with the phallic screws, and then I went. Now I'm going. Then I went for the 80s with the signature piece, and now I'm into the 2000 with the drawings of the drawings and the paintings of these these vaginal pieces that were the angry cunt. And also I used a combination, it was the Big Bang, the women at the center, it was an explosive image, and it was also, women are angry, they're angry for many reasons, they're angry because they didn't have access to the system, but there's also an enormous amount of energy that is out there.
So, and, wait.
Go ahead.
we want to fast forward a little,
okay.
Because there are decades in there. Judith very diplomatically said to me, "Well, Kathy, I kind of lost touch with your work for a couple of decades." And that was because I had a small audience for my work. Of course she lost touch with it. But we're going to fast forward to now,
right.
Because I want to hear Judith's story and I want to try and tell my story. You got some big breaks. Can we talk about, like, how did we change a situation from being not very visible to being more visible?
Well, I had an enormous amount of luck in this situation. I had a one-person solo show at the Mitchell Algis Gallery, and Paul McCarthy came to that show and loved the work. He remembered it when I was censored in the 70s, and he was interested in buying a few pieces. So then he actually had a gallery, which he still has, in California. This is called the Box LA.
And but Judith, why do you think he would? I remember that Mitchell Algis show. We were all talking about it.
Right.
Mitchell Algis was a dealer who felt it was very important to show artists that had a history and that were not showing enough.
That's right.
And you had a signature, you had a Judith.
Yes.
And some, if you knew Judith's work, you would recognize it. So what do you think it was that he said, "Oh man, I have this"? Because Mitchell Algis showed lots of artists that had solo shows and they didn't then take off the way you did.
Well, also Paul McCarthy came to the gallery because he was interested in showing another artist that Mitchell had taken on, Bob Mallory. He went there, just happened to go at the time, serendipitous. He went there at the time that my show was on, and he really was flabbergasted by it. He loved it.
Why?
Oh my God! Well, Paul's work is very sexual and political too.
Okay, that's
so
what I
so
to
there's
say.
No question. There's no question. It wasn't just, oh my God. It was just someone's work. It was also fit into his own aesthetic, and also it was very impactful. And he wanted me to show at the gallery in L.A. And his daughter, who is the dealer, Mara McCarthy, came to New York, and she offered me a one-person show over the phone.
How did you feel?
Fabulous. I mean, you know, it was actually fabulous, but I have to say that. It was so naive. She came to New York and asked to come to my studio on my birthday, and I was teaching at a school in the Bronx. And she said, "Oh, I'd like to come to your studio." I said, "Oh, well, I'm really busy tomorrow, maybe some other time." And I thought, "Oh my God." I mean, I hung up and I thought, "I have brain damage. This is really pathetic." And I called Star 86, which you know you can redial the number. And so I remembered that, and I said, "Come to my studio," and that's actually how it started. I also considered it very lucky that it was my birthday, so it was it worked out very well. But from there,
hold it.
Okay.
So I'm going to tell my big break, which after I got my MA from SUNY Purchase, they gave me a course to teach, a sort of course that no one else wanted to teach, that kind of course. And there was a student, a young man named Brendan Cass, who one day I was putting my coat on and he said, "Are you driving back to New York?" And I said, yes. And he said, can I come with you? And I thought, an hour drive with a student? I said, yes. Then when we got to Manhattan, Brooklyn, he said, can I come to your studio? I said, yes. When he came to my studio, he said, you know, the whole bottom part of that painting over there needs a lot more color. And these two paintings here, they're kind of canceling each other out. I mean, I really think you could take out the heavy black outlines. I don't think you need that at all. But this little one here, I think, is probably the best thing in your studio. And you know what? I thought he was right. And I listened to him. And it was the beginning of a long conversation. He, at the time, had a gallery that he was working with on Christie Street with Chinatown called Canada. And he said to me, hey, Professor Bradford, I want to take you to this new young gallery, and I want to introduce you to them. He did. I went. I never forget the night. It was kind of a wild, I think I already said scrappy. How can I describe what that was like? But he said, hey, guys, dudes, this is Katherine Bradford. I really think you should show your work. And they didn't say anything. But I got a lift of what that gallery was like. It was experimental. It loved painting. It loved painterly painting. It loved taking risks. It had a great spirit. It really had a following of artists that were very involved in the program. It was a gallery that became a launching pad for young artists, for example, Joe Bradley, Michael Williams, Katherine Bernstein. And I agreed to all their work because the art world at that time was not so friendly to painting, not so friendly to emotional subject matter, not so friendly to painterly painting. Well, I was in a group show, I went to the openings, I realized this was a place that showed work that I really loved. And it was only 2 years ago that they came to my studio, and I had been working as hard as I could to make paintings that I felt like, if you're going to show in that gallery, you better make paintings. I was thinking, I have to make paintings like Katherine Bernhardt and Joe Bradley. But I didn't think I could do that. But anyway, I tried my best. I made bigger paintings. And the studio was life-changing because they accepted me as I was. They said, we're going to give you a show in a big space. By then they had moved to Broome Street, where they are now. We're going to give you a show in big space. And it was a big break for me because I had an audience, a lively audience that I don't think I could have reached otherwise. The moral of the story is, listen to your students.
Well, of course, it depends on the students.
I am giving myself credit for realizing that Brendan Cass had something valuable to say.
No, you were very lucky, and it was really transforming to be able to have that dialogue. That was great.
Lucky.
That's right.
How much do you think all of this is luck?
I think that there's some of it's luck, but I don't think it's all luck. I think that
when you're doing something at a certain time frame, it actually fits into the zeitgeist of the time. So if it does, then it can really work for you. I think luck is a factor, but I don't think that is the only thing. I know that I was in a couple shows at in Hazardworth in London and one in Zurich, and Chris Durkin, who was then the director of the Tate Modern, said, your work actually is important because the past work is actually valuable and important now. It's not just you did it in the past. And also, I also went farther with the work in terms of, not that that was not enough, it was just that I extended my sensibility to other things that were also very current. And it was a time frame that raw political and sexual work were something that that there was an audience for, that people wanted to hear, they wanted to see, and it worked out for them.
I think when you say you extended your sensibility, to me, I would include large paintings,
right,
really colorful,
right,
really impromptu. Like, I saw a video of Judith.
I saw a video.
New York Times video.
Oh, yes, I haven't read.
And she stands in front of a painting with a loaded brush and paints it in front of a camera, which is not something I would ever do. In fact, when we were talking about this conversation, Judith, characteristically said to me, oh, Kathy, you know, we could have a wonderful conversation, let's just wing it.
Yeah. That's my style.
Yeah, and I thought, you know, I've got to listen to this. This person has something to teach me. But a point that I think is very important and that both of us want to make is that Judith says, her imagery evolved. I will say that I made a lot of changes, not enormous changes, but I made changes that I think are important. I was no longer in a conventional marriage. I fell in love with a beautiful, soulful woman who I married 2 years ago, and she's sitting beautifully over there. And I made my paintings bigger, a little bolder. It would not be made to write cum face on my paintings. I don't think I could bring myself to do that.
I'm not suggesting everyone should take the trajectory that I did. I'm just, this was one of the
Do I feel like I'm suggesting everyone should do what I'm
saying? No, I'm not saying that. I'm just clarifying
for
the audience.
Yeah. No, I was a visiting artist at Ohio State, and this student came running up to me and said, I met my husband and I'm in love with a woman. I was upset. Anyway. And one of the important things I did was to put people in my work. After years of trying to avoid figuration, because I hung out with abstract painters, people who were pushing the envelope of painting, were not necessarily putting human beings in their work. I watched Carol Dunham go from putting styrofoam balls on his abstractions to eventually inventing a way to depict a human form in his work and playing with it, kind of telling stories with it. I kept my eye on that. I looked at artists who were doing that, and I thought, I have to figure out a way how to put humanity into my work in my own terms. And when I did that, the interest in what I was doing became much greater. And the reasons for that, I don't know, and I don't think I have to know. You want to talk about changing your work?
Well, I changed my work because I had other I had other things to say, because many of us have a lot of things to say, not just one thing. So one thing led to something else, and kind of like telephone. And also now I'm doing an anti-Trump series, which I can't tell you, yes, is just fabulous. And absolutely necessary, and it is, you know, someone had come to my studio and said, I'm so jealous of you that you can actually get out all the anger, all the rage, all the things that you have through your work, and I'm doing that now, and that's where I'm at right at this moment. So this is a great time for me.
When I go to my studio, no matter what the headlines are, I go into a kind of otherworldly place, almost dreamlike, where I'm involved with making the most beautiful colors and mood that I can, a place of fantasy, personal. And I feel a little bit defensive now.
Do not, by the way. I think your work has a lot of magic in it, and there is room, there is obviously room in the metaphorical table for many, many different sensibilities, and you're getting so much now because your work is, a lot of people relate to the work that you have, and that's why it's important at this time.
To escape into?
Well, I think escape can be something that's really very valuable too. We're not just one tone, one note. There are so many facets that we all have, and I think that your work is another facet of what people want to see and want to relate to. So that's great for you at this point, at this time, as well as probably any time. Very magical. Yes, you want to say something?
I think the reason everybody relates to both of your work is because both are extremely honest, and there's a lot of work that's not honest. So, thank you very much. And I just wanted to read this very famous quote that Oprah says, you both are talking about love. And she said, I believe love is preparation meeting opportunity.
Yes.
If you hadn't been prepared when the opportunity came along, you would not have been lucky.
That's correct, by the way. That's correct. So it's not just, it's not all magic, by the way. It is also all the work that's been put in behind that. Yeah. And there was someone who wanted to ask a question before that. Yes, go ahead, sir.
Hello, my name is Francine. I came to New York 12 years ago. I'm an artist too. And I thought it was a place for where women are the most emancipated in the world. I came to visit with.
Can you all hear her?
Maybe you should go to the microphone. That, thank you.
She said she came to New York because New York was the place where women were the most emancipated in the world.
And I came to myself. And I came to Louise Bourgeois because she was the age of my grandma, 94 years old at this time, and I thought, how did she make it at that high level? And when I met her, I saw in her eyes she was so tough.
She was very tough. I knew Louise. She was a genius, she was fabulous, and she was very determined. There was a lot of insecurity she had too, but I will tell you, she had found her métier, and her time frame was when she was much older, and it was an extraordinary thing to see the work that came out of her, subconscious, and the extraordinary creativity that she developed as an older woman, as well as a younger work too, but also as an older person.
And she was able to show us that insecurity. We could relate to it.
Vulnerable, yeah.
Yes, she was very vulnerable. The vulnerability, yes.
lot of pain. But my question is, 12 years after, have things changed?
I'm sorry, you said 12 years after?
I came 12 years
after. Oh, 12 years after, yes, yes, yeah.
Have things changed? I'm so shocked, but everything's going on, you know? Have things changed? I'm in Hoboken, land of Trump land.
I know exactly what you're talking about. I cannot believe. First, I cried when Barack Obama came, because I never thought that a black man could become president.
Yeah,
I thought it was just extraordinary that it happened in my lifetime. And then also to go with Donald Trump when he was elected, I cried for another reason. And it is a very, very sad comment on this time frame that someone with the bombastic, the crude, has so little knowledge of what is going on and proud of it, and he is just the pits. We really hit rock bottom, but I hope we don't go any lower.
Can I change the subject?
Sure.
The point is, I'm feeling things are in balance, and an artist has kind of mission how to balance things.
Thank you.
Did you want to ask a question, Adrian?
Yes.
Great.
It's a two-part question.
Bring it.
Do you believe that painting is political, and can we paint the world that we want to live in, and then live in it?
Adrian, who by the way is director of Canada Gallery and has been my savior, asks if we can paint the world we want to live in. Yeah. Let me think, cunties.
I've been told that, by the way. I think we can paint the world that we would like to live in. But I will tell you frankly, you can't live in a painting. You know something, I do think that if you have something unique to say, and it is impactful for the time frame, and it is important, and people relate to it, then it can be very important to do. Yes. The answer is yes.
And my answer is, I think you can create the community you want to live in, which is very important to me. And my paintings are often about being together with like-minded people. And one thing that I really depend on is being close to other artists and seeing what they're doing, seeing them through their times, cheering them on, giving them critique when they need critique and applause when they need applause. Also, I like to make paintings that I like to look at, which is what Bernard Newman said. He said, I made these paintings because that I need them to look at. No, he didn't say that. What did he say? This is what I like to look at. This is what I want to look at. So I try to make my paintings upbeat and about subjects that I want to keep in my mind and dwell on. And I thought maybe that's why I was invited to speak as a sort of point, counterpoint to Coco, who has another approach to her intentions in art, and mine are very different. And I'm getting on the defensive.
I don't see any reason. I see no reason for that. That's all. I see no reason for that. This is a great time frame, and it's also, I know that it's actually very unusual for people to find mentors when they're much older. So that this is really an extraordinary thing, and I know for me, this is the best time of my life because my work is valued and I'm valued, and that's a very important thing. And I think that most artists are looking for that, not only the doing work that is important to them, but also wanting some validation from the outside community.
And that's a very important that's a very important thing. And it's great, and I agree with Kathy in terms of going out and finding a community that can value what you're doing and have that dialogue, and therefore you can feel that camaraderie, and it is a wonderful thing to have.
How are we doing for time?
Yeah.
Good. Okay, more questions?
And
a comment.
Questions or comments?
You know, I'll tell you something. I don't have all the answers. I just have answers that have worked for me.
And Judith, I've known you for a long time.
That's so true.
I've seen you for a while. And I didn't know Kathy's work. I love it, though. And I love the way you both evolved. And it seems to me that the answer to what people have been asking, well, there are a lot of them. I'm an art historian rather than an artist. So having watched kind of what's happened and so on, Judith Moore came to the world that she wants to get out of her system, I think, that she wants to get away from. She certainly doesn't want to be part of that world that she's painting. It's the anger. And I think the magic word is to be persistent. It's what my father told me when I was little. He said, "You're so persistent." He said, "I just hope you use it for something good someday." And I think you both used it. You've been so persistent. And your work is more the work that you, more the community that you want. So one is trying, it's sort of two sides of the same thing. You want to get away from the world and get it out of your system. You want to paint the world you want to be part of. And art can be both of those things. And of course, you're using beautiful and sumptuous colors and contours and incredible technique, or it wouldn't work. So it's a question.
But I also use a lot of humor.
Yes,
you have something that is a very important thing.
And I don't think
it's uplifting because of the fact that it's very powerful, because the humor is a big part of what I'm about, and I use it also in the verbiage, and also it's a very important part of my work. Yeah.
Do you think those early black screws, which were so threatening that they got censored out of the show, do you think there was humor in them?
Well, I'll tell you something. I think that yes and no. It's humorous to think that these large screws became phalluses, and they actually, and it's like it's a pop art, but it went to a whole different level because of the hairiness, and also it was very much about war, anti-war, feminism, and as I said, mine's bigger than yours, and also men have a phallus, but women, but they don't own the image. So I think that at the time it was too threatening. Now it's a different time frame. We're in a different world than we were then. And it's hard for me to say, but there were a fair amount of men, a fair amount of the population that was very threatened by it. Yes.
Any more questions? When I stand in front of Judith's paintings, that's funny.
No. Go ahead. It's not funny.
I'm transported by her brushwork and her color and the speed, which I can feel in them. I feel they're celebratory in
yes,
a way.
Yes.
And that's what I respond to. And I remember when I first saw a big colored painting of yours, it was at the New Museum.
Right.
I just thought, my God, this was the woman doing the giant charcoal drawing class at Purchase. She has come a long way.
Well,
she changed the tone of the work.
Yeah.
And it's really important.
It was actually very much a rebirth, is what it comes down to. And the work, by the way, is about the Big Bang. It's about the solar system. It's actually a metaphor between men and women, and the and the birth. And so there's a lot of subtext to the work that I do that deals with these images on a psychological level. So, but I would say that I have really expanded, and it's not done yet is what it comes down to. And I'm really, yeah, thank you.
Really a comment and just in a Coco Fusco mode of thanking professors many years later. So I'm now an art historian, but I was an ARTspace student at SUNY Purchase in the 90s.
Oh wow.
And I remember Judith coming to my studio, and I happened to have been looking at a Gorilla Girl. I was a Gorilla Girl for a long time. Yeah, yes, you said it. And I was looking at an exhibition, I don't know, some journal, and you know, there was this figure, and back then all these, I don't think I ever saw you, about a black knee skirt, black tights, and Chuck Taylor. And then I was looking at a picture of that with a gorilla mask, and then you walk into my studio wearing like the exact same outfit. And I just thought, oh, this woman is so effing cool. And I could not believe how lucky I was that you were there. And what it did for me truly was a model of way of interacting in the world. And as I went on to study art history and dealt with a lot of men, I often thought about you coming into my studio that way. And I knew very well what your history had been with the earlier exhibitions.
Yeah.
I was a little bit of an art historian back then too.
Right.
And you very well. And anyway, so it's really just a thank you to you, because it really has made an enormous difference in my life.
You know something, I can't tell you how much what you said means to me. I really feel like crying. Because you know something? No, yeah. You call me out on it. But I'll tell you frankly, you know something, when you're teaching, you put a tremendous amount of energy out, and you honestly do not know that anyone is actually hearing one word you say or cares about it or anything else. And it's very rewarding to really feel that you've made some kind of impact and some dent. And I actually taught at SUNY Purchase for over 30 years as an adjunct.
Yes, I know.
And I taught at Queens College as an adjunct for 15 years. So I have spent my entire life actually teaching in academia. I was not rewarded by getting full-time jobs, but it served me, so it was possible for me to have the life I had. I never felt deprived, even if I was not showing or selling or making and getting the perks that a full-time job has. But that doesn't mean I didn't want more, so to speak.
I
thank you so much for saying that. It means a great deal to me.
Well, it
really,
totally
it does.
True.
Yeah.
But
I asked Judith if she would like to talk about academia.
I said no,
and she said no.
One of the reasons was that recently I was very ill, and I was practically carried out of the classroom. But I have retired from academia. But hey, I'm only 75. Hey, give me a break. I taught for actually 50 years, almost 50 years.
Yeah,
straight. Yeah.
Any more comments or questions? How's our time? Yes. We still have time.
We still have 15 minutes.
Wow.
Hi. I've been trying to figure out a way to articulate this question, but you both mentioned a sort of transformation or rebirth of your practices.
Right.
And I am a student.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Get the mouth.
How close do I have to speak?
Like a rock singer.
should I repeat that?
Yeah.
Okay, just wondering.
Closer.
What's
it? No.
Is that closer?
Nope.
Yeah. Is that
better? No, she's not.
Yeah. wondering if you both have mentioned a transformation or rebirth in your practice that allowed you to get where you are now. And as a student, I'm just wondering what it was to go through that process of transformation and whether or not that was more like reflective of political or socioeconomic atmosphere at the time or more like an introspective transformation.
No, it doesn't make sense. You know, it's funny. I had a couple of books published recently. One called "Dicks of Death," surprise title for me, and the other one is Judith Bernstein Rising. And but it's I think that it, the reason I'm mentioning this is because I had a talk with Thomas Michelli, who writes for Hyperallergic. And he mentioned that he felt that my work, each time there was a different president, that my work took on a different meaning. And it was very tied to the political climate. But I will say that enormous amount of it came from my inner self, really. But I would say that there's a combination. Right now I'm doing things, Trump, obviously, because it seems so much a necessity. Also, the Vietnam War was, well, that was extraordinary because of the fact there was a draft, and that's why you had so many people marching and all that. But I would say that it was a combination for me. You know, my inner, what I wanted to say through my my own inner core, my psychological needs, as well as the surrounding stuff. Now, my work also worked for not only the politics in terms of the president and the larger politics, but also within a smaller politics of the art world. It seems like it's our whole world, but it's smaller than obviously the President of the United States.
Yeah. Well, I was not paying any attention at all to the presidents. I think one thing that really motivated me was being prevented from being who I thought I could become, which was a serious artist for many years. One of my heroes was Elizabeth Murray. When I arrived in New York in the 80s, she was doing work that counted big abstractions. And this was the important part. I knew she was a mother. She had three children. And even more important, she was sane. And she seemed to have a healthy relationship. She was nice to people. She was approachable. All the things that I wanted to keep at the same time as this transformation that you're talking about. So I desperately wanted to be taken seriously, and I really had a lot of work to do, and I threw myself into that job. But I needed some role models, which is maybe why I'm shooting off my mouth right now.
You know, but you know something, what's important is that you're a role model for a lot of people in this audience. This audience wants to hear how we did it, how can they do it, and also where they can find a niche to find what their work is, and they want some inspiration. So that's why people most of the time come here and they want to find something that you have done that they can tie into. And that's why many times the questions are, they're about you, but they're also about themselves. Mm-hmm. So I think that the insecurity that we all felt when we were younger, and we constantly feel, is something that you guys feel, and Louise Bourgeois felt, and we feel, and it's a constant thing to actually fight it. So you're not alone in that feeling.
She said there's something mystical in your art.
Yes.
Well, you know, I came of age as a painter looking at Forrest Bess and Bill Jensen early paintings. That was very much the territory that I wanted to explore. And it's I just saw someone yawn very widely. But it's not something that is uppermost in the discussions these days. But I feel it's an extremely important part of making art. I didn't even say the word spiritual. Maybe we can end on that.